I'm Kweli Washington, and this is Counterculture. Thank you for joining our special campaign coverage of the New York citywide races, Counterculture Politics 2013. As part of our coverage, we do one-on-one interviews with the candidates for public advocate. What, you might ask, is the public advocate? The answer is, the public advocate is one of three citywide offices in New York, and it's the first in line to succeed the mayor. The office is the ombudsman or watchdog for New Yorkers. We've invited every candidate to appear on the program, and we offer them an opportunity to connect with viewers and voters in an authentic way. Now that you've been briefed, let's turn the counter to politics.
I often think of the life I've led, and oh, it's a wonder I ain't dead. Drinking and gambling, staying out all night, living in a fool's paradise.
Our guest this evening is a candidate for the Office of Public Advocate, Letitia James. Ms. James has served as a New York City Council member since 2003, representing District 35 in Brooklyn. She is the chair of the Committee on Economic Development and the Committee on Sanitation and Solid Waste Management. Please welcome Ms. Letitia James.
Hi, how are you?
Councilwoman, thank you so much for being here.
Thank you very much, Mr. Washington.
It's wonderful. Hey, Kweli.
Kweli, okay.
It's wonderful to have you here. So, well, let's get right to it. Let me ask you what have been some of the formative experiences in your life. What have made you the person that you are?
Oh, gee. Well, you know, I come from humble beginnings. My mother scrubbed floors. My father was a janitor. I remember my brother getting in trouble one time and my mother taking me to court when I was young. And everyone in the courtroom did not look like me except for the defendants. I wanted to change that picture, and so I read a book called Simple Justice, and I wanted to go to Howard University School of Law, which was the laboratory, as you know, of the Civil Rights Movement. Graduated, became an attorney, and decided I wanted to represent individuals in the criminal justice system. I represented a number of children and victims of domestic violence.
You worked in legal aid.
Yeah.
You worked as an assistant.
I was an assistant attorney general, counsel in the state legislature, and then, you know, James Davis ran for office, lost. James Davis won. He was the city council member, and we all know what happened. He was assassinated, and I was elected on the third party line, the Working Families Party, and now I've served the city council for the past 10 years, and now I've decided to put my everything on the line.
Sure.
And I'm running for public advocate.
And take it to the next level.
Yeah.
Now, why is it that you want to be a public advocate?
Well, you know, in the last 10 years, I've challenged this administration. I've sort of served as a charter cop. I was concerned about the extension of the third term, which I thought was illegal, and unfortunately unconstitutional and disrespected the will of the people.
Now, if it had been put to a vote, actual referendum to say, hey, should we consider expanding to a third term as opposed to just going directly to the election, would you have felt that that would be tolerable?
Yes. I didn't have any problem with a referendum, and we were pushing for a referendum.
Sure.
But unfortunately, this was a backdoor deal, backroom deal, and I had a serious problem with that. And we had
Backroom deal between?
Between a number of elected officials in the city and an invisible government, the powerful interest in the city of New York, who obviously wanted the mayor of the city of New York to remain in office, and primarily to complete his legacy and to complete a number of major, you know, real estate development deals in the city. And the people had, you know, had spoken. They spoken not once, but twice.
Sure.
And so it was real critically important that we honor and respect the decision of New Yorkers. I challenged the mayor, as you know, on the current system with regards to education. We've closed a number of schools in the city of New York. Teaching to the test has not worked as indicated by the test scores that came out last week.
Sure.
The morale of teachers is at an all-time low. Classroom size has exploded. You know, I led the city forward on the snowstorm. When the mayor failed to declare an emergency in the city of New York, we had hearings all throughout the city of New York and passed significant pieces of legislation.
And so as public advocate, let's address some of these issues around education?
Yeah, the issue of with regards to the public of the Office of Public Advocate is the growing income disparity in the city of New York, the feminization of poverty, the fact that tonight 52,000 children, 52,000 individuals are going to sleep homeless in our shelters, one third of them are children. The fact that most of these children, unfortunately, are not attending schools. We have more and more individuals on public assistance, individuals who are struggling, a disappearing middle class. And so, the mayor of the city of New York has done some really good things, but the direction of the city continues to concern me. The crisis in affordable housing in the district that I represent, I've, you know, seen the great displacement. And so these are some of the issues that I want to focus on.
Motivated you to run for this, for this office. And let me ask, what are the things that the mayor has done well? What are actually some of the things that you think have been successful in the last 12 years?
I love the bike lanes.
I love so do I.
I love the pedestrian plazas. I love recycling.
Sure.
I've worked with him on recycling, and he's been really good with respect to gun control, organizing the mayors in the city of New York.
Sure.
So he's done some really good things.
And actually really creating a national movement
around
as well.
Sure, exactly.
Right?
Yeah. So I applaud him on that. But the crisis in affordable housing and the fact that we're building more and more luxury housing, and there's just an attack on public schools, public libraries, public housing, public hospitals.
Sure.
I stood with the current public advocate, Bill de Blasio, who, as you know, we filed a lawsuit to keep open the Long Island College Hospital as well as Interfaith. We were successful on both, but other hospitals all throughout the city of New York, including the last remaining hospital in the Rockaway, St. John's, is in threatening to close because of lack of funds. So there's a labor and delivery unit in the Bronx at North Central. I mean, and other hospitals are tinkering on bankruptcy. And so this is a major issue.
And as public advocate, how are you going to address those issues of hospital underfunding?
Well, the Office of Public Advocate has five basic functions. One, you can introduce legislation. You can, introduce legislation, hold hearings, and you preside over the city council. You cannot vote. Two, the Office of Public Advocate has a number of appointments. City planning, where we discuss housing policies in the city. I want to talk about permanent affordable housing. I want to talk about mandatory inclusion zones so that when we give benefits to developers, they're mandated to build affordable housing, truly affordable housing for moderate and middle-income families.
And that thing's not happening right
now? That's not happening now. It's voluntary. There's the pension board in the city of New York where I want to talk about targeted investment in communities where we're seeing a significant amount of violence, in neighborhoods where industry is suffering. We need to target our pension dollars. The Office of Public Advocate can issue audits, not financial audits, that's the control job, but performance audits, similar to what I did as a member of the city council where I uncovered the biggest scam in the city known as City Time, and we recovered $500 million.
That was a big IT project that went way over
way
budget,
over.
Took forever, and maybe did or did ever end up working the way it was supposed to.
It did not. We were all ripped off. Contract started out at 46 and ballooned to 800 and no one was watching the store. Two individuals contacted my office. I worked with them and as well as Daily News, and we uncovered the scam and I held the three hearings. And then the Office of Public Advocate has a bully pulpit. The Office of Public Advocate is the watchdog on the mayor of the city of New York. One of the things I was concerned about, I mean, I oppose obesity. I recognize that particularly in communities of color, we've got an obesity problem, but I oppose the slogan primarily because it didn't apply to Starbucks, didn't apply to 7-Eleven, didn't apply to all these convenience stores.
So too many exemptions.
Too many exemptions, and we do not have physical education in our school. And I believe that the mayor trespassed on the role of the city council, which is why being a charter cop is really critically important. And I would have opposed a universal tax, but just to target small businesses that are struggling in the city, I had a problem with
that. It was punitive.
Yeah. So those are some of the functions on the Office of Public Advocate. And clearly, you know, moving forward, I mean, and you can also litigate on behalf of New Yorkers. I'd like to create an office for immigrants, particularly at a time we're looking at immigration reform. It's going to be, I'm sure we'll pass immigration reform under the leadership of President Obama.
And that's actually come up a bit in the debate so far.
It's
some issues of immigration is a national issue, but it's a real issue here.
It's a major issue.
We've got a melting pot. We've got people coming all the time from
different
places and trying to knit them together
into
a community.
Exactly. And we need an Office of Public Advocate to assist these individuals from coming out of the shadow. I also am organizing, in fact, this week, I think Thursday is a strike for low-wage workers in fast food restaurants, and I'm organizing a lot of low-wage workers, individuals who are making minimum wage, who have worked at these fast food restaurants for 20, 25 years, and the owners are billionaires, not millionaires, they're billionaires. And I want to talk about women's issues. You know, we have a lot of limited service, health service centers that are ignoring women's right to choose in the city of New York, and they're basically, they're anti-choice.
And how are they getting away with that?
So they're setting themselves up as these full service centers, and in fact, they're not. They're limited health service centers, and in fact, what they do when they get women in, they don't provide them with the information they need, and a lot of these women are going in for reproductive services, and they're not offering that, no. So it's women's rights I really want to focus on, and obviously empowering parents. It's the Office of Advocate, just to succinctly, we need to reconnect civic engagement.
Sure.
And civic engagement is gone.
Sure.
Primarily because under this administration, government has been the top down as opposed to the bottom up.
I understand. And there's likely going to be a Democratic mayor.
Yes.
And so do you see that as a opportunity for collaboration? Do you see it as an opportunity to kind of hold the mayor accountable? How do you imagine that, given that you guys, you know, potentially be from the same party?
Sure. So we in all likelihood, we'll be from the same party. Mm-hmm. But from time to time, I disagreed with some Democratic individuals in the city of New York. I stood up against a powerful developer in Brooklyn. I challenged the Atlantic Yards project over the abuse of eminent domain, and I took to task some Democrats who supported the project. I thought it was wrong.
Sure.
I have no problem with an arena, but the question is, should you abuse eminent domain to build an arena for a private individual?
I understand. So kind of taking out people's kind of private homes or stores or whatever was there for a major development that's good for many people, but certainly good for the person who's developing it, presumably.
And there's no affordable housing in the project.
And there was initially supposed to be,
they promised a lot of affordable housing, and now, as you read in the New York Times this past week, they may be selling the property, the land, the remaining land, and no affordable housing.
Got it. Mm. Now, actually, just this past week, the VMAs, the Video Awards, took place in your hood,
That's right.
Were you able to check it out?
No.
What was the impact for the people in the community?
So there was a live concert at Dean and Sixth.
Yep.
And so we had meetings leading up to that night.
Sure.
We were meeting for the last 3 months because residents were concerned.
I'd be concerned.
I know. And there
the way Miley Cyrus is dancing for tonight, I'd be concerned.
I know. So, from all indications, you know, the impact to Prospect Heights was minimal.
Uh-huh.
Traffic did back up.
Sure.
But I think as a result of all of the work that we did in preparation for the awards, it worked out. There were some complaints.
And it was
complaints.
Nice to have Brooklyn represented
it was.
That
it
way.
Was. It was very nice.
I was on a bike ride in Brooklyn Bridge Park.
Yeah.
And so I saw that doing the whole setup there. There was also stuff that happened out there. But then I was coming back around and I saw the Afropop Festival, unrelated to the VMAs, but a very exciting flourishing of music. And I understand that that's right there in your district as well, close by.
That's right. It's at Commodore Barry Park, also known as City Park. And I got to give a shout out to Matthew Morgan and Jocelyn Cooper.
We heard it there first. Are they the organizers?
Yes, they're the brainchilds of Afropunk.
Uh-huh.
They came to me last year. I assisted them in organizing it and then getting it at Commodore Park. And what I loved about Afropunk was it was racially ambiguous.
Sure.
The vast majority of people were racially ambiguous.
It wasn't together, different folks and different backgrounds.
Different. It wasn't about black or white. It was about music. It was about feeling. It was about soul.
Sure.
And it was about just being yourself and being an individual and respecting the universal language of music.
I love it. I love it when you see different cultural trends coming together and intersecting. And that's actually part of what our show is about, is cosmopolitanism.
Exactly.
You know, different people.
It was amazing. And I look forward to, you know, Afropunk next week. And the vendors were fabulous. You had macaroni here. You had Japanese food here.
Sure.
You had, you know, it was wonderful.
The entire represented at Commodore Barry Park.
And it was reflective of the community that I serve.
Sure.
Fort Greene, Clinton Hill, Prospect Heights, and Crown Heights. Probably one of the most diverse communities. And that's why it's important to maintain, you know, that diversity by building affordable housing so that we can all live together in a diverse society.
Absolutely.
And learn
so
from really one another.
That's really one of the key priorities.
It's absolutely key.
And as you think about the next few weeks leading up to the primary, what do you see as your key to success?
So the key to success is a ground war. You know, I'm running against individuals who have deep, deep, deep pockets.
Mm-hmm.
They represent the elite. They represent the well-connected and the well-heeled. I don't represent that crowd. I represent everyday New Yorkers, and I stand up against powerful interests in the city. So they have outraised funds. They've got million-dollar ads. They've got Washington insiders supporting them. All I have are, you know, people from the public housing, people from Afropunk supporting me.
Mm-hmm.
I've got a significant number of labor organizations in the city because I've been a voice against working people in the city of New York. And at the end of the day, mm-hmm. I think the depth of my character will overcome the depth of their pocketbook. And I think we will win this and be victorious, and we will be the next public advocate of the city of New York. But I can only do it without your audience and without your listeners making sure they go out and vote on September 10th for Letitia James.
Well, Ms. James, I appreciate you taking the time out this evening.
Thank you so
this
much.
This has been wonderful. It's been
Thank
great
you.
To have you
Thank
here.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.